And so will Joy. Hello, and welcome to the 8th Annual Wild Wisconsin Winter Web Conference. I am Leah Langby with the IFLIS Library System, and I'm moderating the Adult Services track today. Assisting me is Joy Schwartz with the Winnipox Library System. We're glad to have you here. Thanks for joining us. Our presenter for this session is Becky Spratford, who's an author and reader's advisor extraordinaire and trainer from Illinois. She will be discussing providing robust reader's advisory service that values equity, diversity, and inclusion principles. Becky, whenever you're ready, please begin.
Thank you very much, Leah and Joy. Thanks everyone for being here. I want to let everyone know that you will get the resources from the Wild Wisconsin people on the website, but I did make changes to this presentation as late as today, as we'll talk about in a little while. But you can always have the live slides, which are the most up to date for you for this presentation. Those will, that link will hopefully also go out to you, but you can also just go to my blog, RA for All. The link will be at the end. And the other reason I want to tell you that is this presentation, because I'm trying to do a lot in what I'm trying to do is in 50 minutes so that there are time for questions, because there always are questions. I'm going to leave a lot of it to click here if you need more information. So if you want to go right now to raforall.blogspot.com or just search RA for All in Google, you could even follow along on the live slides yourself and click through on things as they interest you. And it is posted there under today. You could just search Wild Wisconsin and find it also. Okay, so I want to also say before we start that I'm not going to beat around the bush in this presentation. I'm going to tell you like it is, and again, give you plenty of places to go get more information. Some of what I have to say is going to make some people uncomfortable. We're going to discuss how librarianship is 88% white women and how white fragility sometimes gets in the way of having real conversations. Also, I realize that some of the things I say are easier to implement at some libraries rather than others. I've worked a lot in Wisconsin, and so I understand some of the challenges. And some things are beyond your control. There's administrative things. But I have enough suggestions here and the basic premise that you can do this anywhere. And I travel all over the country, so I know that this can work because I've done a lot of the stuff I'm going to talk about here. And I'm also going to use myself as an example because I feel like there's no better thing to do than use yourself as an example. Okay, the main theme of this presentation in general is that the time for excuses is over. Because let me tell you, I hear people having a lot of concerns, especially when I propose action. And people start with a lot of, well, but, I can't because, however, and I've heard it all. I've heard it from no one wants to read the diverse books we buy, and I'm going to have an example of a town between me and you where a whole bunch of rich old white ladies are reading diverse books. To, it's not my fault that most of the books published are written by white men. To, the one that is my favorite when people get upset is, do you want me to read every classic? I go into library systems and I always include equity, diversity, inclusion as part of my talks. And I even use a range of examples. I do that when I'm not giving this talk. When I book talk, I go out of my way to make sure I'm book talking books with POC characters, LGBTQ titles, books with straight white male protagonists also. I book talk them all equally. But I also challenge those in the rooms and don't let them get away with microaggressions. And throughout today, I'm going to give examples. I'm going to give you example book talks. I'm going to give you example titles. I'm going to help you get started. But here are some examples of microaggressions that I want to make sure we're talking about. So one time I was giving a talk somewhere and someone started book talking and she started book talking by saying that the book had Indians in it. And I said, okay, stop. I said, we need to clarify, are those Native Americans or are they from India? And she was like, oh, they're Native Americans. I'm like, great, because when you say Indians, it's not clear. It's not that you're making people feel bad. You're just trying to let them know, look, you just have to make sure you're clarifying. I also am going to talk to you about how to stop thinking you don't have the skills to do what you need to do, because you do, and we're going to actually put everything in the frame of reader's advisory things that you have. We're just going to talk about how we all put EDI issues at the forefront and put those values really into work, not just talk the talk, but walk the walk. We're going to show that we do this. And part of that is admitting that we're all part of the problem, is acknowledging that you have this white blindness and that you don't really know. We're going to talk about ways to do that and how to do this better. But the overall point I'm trying to make today is that we should all stop worrying about simply buying diverse books, because that alone is not going to help us. I'm going to make the argument that instead we need to focus on traditional RA service and just put that new lens of EDI in the front. That will lead us not only to be able to help identify more diverse titles for our collections, but also, and this is the key, get our patrons asking about them too. And again, many, many examples throughout this. I do want to say something though, that this all sort of is framed by, it's now over a year, it's about a year ago almost exactly, that I really started focusing on this. And we're going to talk about why and how in a few minutes. But this curating and promoting diverse collections is non-negotiable is a much longer post where I laid a lot of this out as to why it's a problem. And that's really, if you want to understand where the presentation you're going to hear came from, that's the place where this started. It started a year ago. It has changed over time, but I think it's important to go back and look at that. And I will refer to that post again in a moment. But I do want to start with my journey, because I think, again, it's important that if I'm going to be calling out white ladies that are in the library world, I'm going to start with myself, the typical white lady in the library world. There's going to be no shaming here, because we have to make sure that we change our mindset, but also don't let ourselves be part of the problem. We are all at fault, even POC library workers. And again, I should say that means people of color. I'm trying not to use too many acronyms, but I do want to go quickly. So none of us can rise above and reach a more inclusive service and environment without starting somewhere. And everyone's journey is going to be a little different. And I hope to share some of mine. Again, I am the most basic of library ladies, and I think that that's important. And that's one of the reasons why the people I work with, especially Annabelle Mortensen's on this page, and also Robin Bradford, and I'll talk about Annabelle in a minute, who's an African-American librarian. The three of us are going to be doing a panel at ALA, which is in Chicago, about doing sort of EDI in collection development and readers advisory. And I'll talk about a very shortened version of this talk, but Annabelle's going to talk about auditing collections and Robin's going to talk about collection development. So, you know, I think it's really important that you check yourself very regularly and you're remembering that, you know, you can be in a bubble with your white blindness, even the most well-meaning of us. But if you have people to check in with and you're listening all the time, which we'll also talk about later. But let me go back a little bit to talk about Annabelle, because this is where back in 2017, I first realized how big a problem this was. Not to say that I didn't always talk about I'll talk later about how I always had as part of my own personal training, making sure I read books by different voices. But during that program that there are links to that the Adult Reading Roundtable did at Skokie Library, where Annabelle works, and Annabelle is a Cuban American librarian. She's on the Library Reads Board. She gave a very meaningful talk, and she gives me permission to use this in my talks, where she was talking about buying for a specific collection at Skokie, where it's sort of like they're anticipating demand. It's not lucky day in that the books are already bestsellers. They're sort of saying these books are coming out. They buy them 3 months in advance, and they're sort of books they think people will be talking about. And she was buying for that collection, and she was like, I just bought two books by women from India. That's maybe too many books by women from India this month. And then she paused and she said she literally did a double take on herself. She was like, wait a second. I would never say that about buying books by white men. Two is not even enough, you know, for the amount I order for those. But I said it about two books by women from India. Yeah, I can't do that. And it's even worse, she said, because I'm a person of color myself. And I did that. That's how ingrained this really is. I also have a longer story then that came after that. So that was my mind frame. And then about a year after that, I was put in the position to be on the Bram Stoker Award Committee for the Horror Writers Association for Lifetime Achievement. And I'm not going to go through the whole story, so you can click there to read it if you're interested in your own time. But I had a chance to give it to a well-known white man, Graham Masterton, or Linda Addison, and who is a name you might not know as much, although since we've given her the Lifetime Achievement Award, she's gotten a lot more of those from other people, but she's an extremely well-known science fiction and horror poet and editor. She's won numerous awards, and she's one of those behind-the-scenes names that everybody in the genres know. She happens to be a Black woman who grew up in inner city Philadelphia, and I talked about being forced to confront my bias and how I acted. And it's still something I say is one of my proudest professional moments. But I didn't necessarily get there in a straight line. I did think about voting for Graham Masterton, a white man, who ended up winning it the next year, by the way, which I thought would happen. But I was like, well, more people know his name. And I almost chickened out and voted for two, Graham and Linda. But bestselling author Grady Hendrix was on our committee, and I will forever love him to this day for this, and he knows this. But he made us all pick one. We had to have unanimous to pick one or two. And he's like, we're picking one, people. And I said, you know what? I can't sit here and say that I support EDI values and that I understand that people of color have been left behind, not through any fault of their own, and they haven't gotten recognition purely because of the color of their skin and the implicit bias in publishing. And that's not Graham Masterson's fault, but Linda Addison is just as deserving. And if I don't act, she may never get the chance again. And that is an example of checking your privilege, because I almost did it too. So that's my journey. So I want to talk to you a little bit about, I do want to go back a minute too, that when I do go speak places, always I get emails, and I still get them a couple a week, just because I'm an ally, from non-binary people of color thanking me after I appear at their libraries, because these emails are uplifting and frustrating, because they'll say, you know, you said the things I've been saying to people for years, but they don't listen to me because I look different than them. But because you look like all of them, they listen to you. It's upsetting, and I understand it, and I take my job seriously, which leads me to what we're going to do today. I'm trying to build bridges between the different groups so that we can have a conversation without feeling bad and without yelling at each other, but also without the guilt coming into play. So I like to talk about how really providing diverse, inclusive, and equitable collections and services is not a straight path. It's more like building a house. And think about it. A house isn't necessarily built in order. The pieces are laid on top of each other, but like sometimes you put up the frame and then you put in the inside stuff, the plumbing and the electricity, and then you put up the walls. But even, and can you tell I live in an old house? You know, sometimes you're doing something and you start the plumbing and you have to stop till the electrician comes, then you go back to the plumbing. It just doesn't go in order. Even though a house has very straight lines and looks like it's very orderly, it doesn't necessarily get built in a straight line. And that's what's going to happen here today. On the screen is the order of how I'm going to tell you how we're going to sort of build our EDI house. But it really is a winding road. All the pieces are going to fit together, layer on top of each other. You're going to be going back and forth between them. You can't just buy diverse collections and expect them to circulate on their own. You can't suggest diversely if you don't have more than two or three titles to mention. And you can't be successful if readers can't find own voices titles on their own. Discoverability is one of the pieces that is missing always. And we're going to talk about that. So I'm going to lay out my blueprint. I'm going to make sure we're tackling problems as they rise. I'm going to bring up common questions and concerns. You will have more. I will have time for those at the end. And I just want you not to do the like, well, if you just buy the collections, they will come, because that's not going to happen. This is my blueprint. Again, there's way more here than any one person can do. You can draw your own blueprint after you hear this presentation, and then you can create your own strong EDI home. But I am going to say that everyone needs to start at the same place. And I say what we do in libraries is we always use mission statements. And so I think that's where we should begin with our EDI work. Because if you really put into words what you're trying to do and create a mission statement for yourself, you really will live up to it, because you have something to bounce off of, to say, this is what I'm doing. So again, you can go see the statement post and the explanation, which goes back to that curating diverse collections is non-negotiable post. The very short version is, and I have a link from her later too, this is why I'm going to bring it up, is April Hathcock, who is part of the ALA counselors, had an experience a year ago at ALA Midwinter that was very upsetting, and she was treated very poorly and extremely racist manner, and did not take it lying down. And her and I conversed, and I told her how, you know, that she inspired me to finally act. I always was talking about that I had EDI values in my programs. Like, I would always like show it, not tell it. And then I realized, no, I need to be more blatant. And you can read again more about why I wrote it. My statement lives on the page where I list my presentations, but it also is in every single contract I make people sign now. I am telling people that this is important to me, and that, you know, I'm going to discuss these issues, and if you're not okay with that, I'm not coming to your library. Now, since I've posted this mission statement, the page where the mission statement is has had, or that original post, had over 2,000 views, and I've had over 36 people tell me or ask permission to use this idea and use my example to create their own EDI mission statements. Literally get them all the time. Don't ask me, do it. I'm telling you, mine is specifically for me and what I do, so it's not gonna work for you exactly, but you can take this as an idea and make sure that you understand that if you make it your mission, there's a better chance you're gonna do it. So I really think that that's the best place to start with whatever you're doing, is sit down and really think about what are you trying to do by having this mission to be more conscious. And we're gonna talk about ways to be more conscious of the Own Voices books that you're talking about and recommending. Okay, so now what we can do is, and if you create that mission statement, it's a lot more easy to just go back and say, hey, I'm just gonna do what I do, but I have this sort of new filter. So we're gonna take the basic skills we already have and simply apply them with that purpose. Take your mission statement as that purpose and then just start doing basic rules of Reader's Advisory. Many of you have probably participated in or seen my RA for All talk, which is really the basic rules of Reader's Advisory. I have them posted, all of them on my webpage there at that link, but one of them is read widely. And all the way back since my first job in Reader's Advisory back in 2000, at the turn of the century, I was given a reading plan. I was supposed to make sure I read broadly. There was a marginalized voices aspect even back then. I had to read at least 3 books from what we were then calling multicultural viewpoint. And I'm going to talk about the problematic nature of that word now, but at the time, I'm going to talk about that at the end, but at the time, I understood what that meant, and I thought that was great. So I had to read at least 3 of those books, and I also had to have at least 1 LGBTQ book, because in my community, this was imperative. My feelings have evolved, as you're going to see, but the idea that we need to read widely is foundational to Reader's Advisory. You should have a plan to read as broadly as you can. Again, use your mission statement to guide you, or get help from a reading challenge. So you can make a plan to consciously add own titles to your reading by getting help from others, like Book Riot has a great reading challenge, and that first link will send you to their Goodreads page with all the reading challenges. And it's just a good way to remind yourself to read broadly. Or you can make one for your library. And this is where I'm talking about the old white ladies not far from you. So Deerfield, Illinois made their own reading program, and it won the Adult Reading Roundtable's ILA, Illinois Library Association Award for Reader's Advisory Service of the Year last year. Basically, they challenged their readers during the winter, during their patrons, to read more broadly and to read more diversely. And oh my goodness, was it successful. And again, as the woman who ran it, Melissa told me, these are rich old white ladies, the people you think wouldn't want to read about people that they don't quote unquote identify with. But not only was it a success, everyone was thankful for the books they were being exposed to and seeking out more on their own. You can use their reading logs. There's permission for you to use it. Just give them credit, and it's linked there. Now, the common complaint that I get, though, okay, so that's reading more consciously, right? Sprinkling those books in if you're not doing it already. Identifying titles. The nice thing about both of these reading plans is they sort of give you a broad topic. So like currently, I believe the Goodreads topic currently is like a book by an Indigenous author. And then there's something else like format related, usually like an audiobook. So there's different ways you can do it, right? But the most common complaint I get is that I don't have time to read. There's too many books I have to read already. I have to read my library's bestsellers and they're all white. Okay, remember that house metaphor, right? If you only read the white books, you're going to build a house that's only white, right? Those are the only books that are going to stay popular. We have to attack the issue from every angle in order to put that house in order to make it right. But here, I'm going to talk about how we can do that in a little bit, but why not read about those white books? Because reading about books is also one of my basic rules of Reader's Advisory. Because see, there's this thing called the internet we have now. So you can read about books, read reviews, read articles about them, stay up to date. I have a whole longer piece about how to best read about books. And if you're reading about books and you're familiar with them, you don't necessarily have to read them. It's just as important, right? So here's a great idea, right? So maybe you see those white bestseller books. Maybe instead of reading those, all those white bestsellers, you can read about those so you know they're coming out, and then read a book that you might not have read otherwise to see that book from cover to cover. So anyway, that's just my advice on that. The other thing is, in general, we need to think like a reader, not a library worker. And I think this is just generally good advice. So I have a lot of people say, well, I have trouble, you know, identifying with a book by someone who isn't like me. And I'm not sure I'm the right person to advocate for a book by a gay author if I'm heterosexual. And that's fine. I totally understand that, but that doesn't mean you have an excuse not to do it, right? To not read diversely. So why not read reviews, but especially not just professional reviews. Read the reviews of readers, especially the 5-star readers. So you go into a book that maybe you don't think you can identify with, and you don't feel comfortable book talking. You read it, you liked it. I think a great example is Patsy by Nicole Dennis Benn, which was Jenna Bush's book club book over the summer. And I have a longer review about it on my website. I really like Nicole Dennis Benn. She's a Jamaican lesbian author. Both of her books have bestsellers. She writes great women's fiction in general and really good stories. And so I had people say, well, I have trouble like book talking a book about a lesbian woman from Jamaica. I'm like, okay, fine. If I have ways to book talk it on my review for you on my blog, but if you're uncomfortable with that, that's fine. Go read one of those 5-star Goodreads reviews and say, think about how a reader who really enjoyed it talked about it, and understand what people liked about it, and maybe you'll understand the book a little bit more. I also always say, though, make sure you read 2-star reviews so you can see any counter opinions, especially if there are people that identify as the same as the author. Sometimes it's good to hear those. Now, if it's just somebody hating on the book, ignore it. But anyway, the whole point is here, you need to be a role model. You're taking this class right now. You're one of the people that is going to be leading on this issue. So make sure that you're reading books by a wide assortment that's extremely inclusive of by all people in all genres too, so that you can help and set the standard. Now, the next thing is, though, is talking about suggesting diversely. And I'm going to talk about some books here. And I think all of the books I'm talking about are mentioned in, if you go to the live slides, to the live Google, in the notes. So I won't have to repeat the titles. And I might add in one or two more, but I will go back and add those. Okay. The first thing I want to tell you is you can't suggest books you haven't read is something I hear all the time for people. Again, there's this thing called the internet, and that you can. Stop saying that. Again, another excuse that I'm shooting down. Use the words of others. Use those Goodreads reviews. Use the reviews in Booklist and Library Journal. You know, we use resources. You don't claim those words are yours, but you can say, you know, Becky said on RA for All about Patsy, or, and I'm going to do a few book talks for you in a minute, but you could say this review in Library Journal said this, or a reader who gave it 5 stars on Goodreads said this. It's a resource. Using resources is what library workers do. For some reason, we think when it's reader's advisory, we're not allowed to do it. It's okay. You could just admit you didn't read it, but here are people that did, and here's what they had to say. Patrons actually only want to know that someone read it. I hear this from another excuse from people, like, well, my patrons want my opinion. Don't hold yourself in such high regard. I did this for 15 years at a desk. Yes, they liked my opinion. But when I hadn't read it and I said to them, so-and-so read it, or this review read it, or I saw it, something about it online here, or someone on Goodreads said this, they were like, oh, great. They don't care as much as you think about your opinion. They just want somebody to tell them, hey, I read it and it's worth your time. That's what they want. All right. So again, not an excuse you can use. The other thing I want to talk to you about, though, is besides just talking about diverse books, we need to make sure that we are creating lists that are diverse. We need to audit our lists. So when you put out, like, for example, I have committed to never having only white male reader likes in every review I do for Booklist. I just turned in a book review on Monday for a book that was very white male book, but its theme was sort of, it was very harrowing psychological horror with a revenge theme. Now, it was very clearly Peter Straub read-alike for people who like classic Peter Straub. But I also realized that it was like Enya Alborn or Jack Jemick, two other horror authors. It'll be out in, it's called The Boy in the Box. It'll be out in like a month in Booklist. And I was like, I can put these there too. Even though it's a very male book, it's mostly male characters, there's a lot connected to this. I will never just do white male read-alikes. Same way, when you make a list, you got to make sure that you're not only recommending books that are just men or just white people or just able-bodied people or, you know, just binary. So you have to institute an own voices requirement in everything you do. Audit your work, audit the suggestions you're making, audit the lists you're making. What I use as my standard is Book Riot. Their standard is 30%. Every list they put out is 30% diverse and at least 50% male-female. Now, I have a link there. It doesn't explicitly give that 30% number to their editorial policy, but Kelly Jensen, one of their editors, did give me permission to share that 30% number, and they kind of outline it very vaguely there, what they're doing, but they're making it clear that they put that at the forefront. They also have a great 5-part series on why reading diversely is important, which is something else I think you can use to educate yourself and your coworkers. But the thing is that it's not, I hear people say, well, that's racist saying you have to do it. No, it's not. It's putting that EDI lens in the forefront and saying, I understand that marginalized peoples were left out of the conversation for so long. We're going to talk about how our collections got too white over time and how to counterbalance that. But there are people who get upset. And again, this is that white fragility. These are some of the people who are outright racist. Those people we just have to confront very bluntly. But a lot of it is, but that's wrong. I don't see color. You have to. You have to because it's been so unfair. And by the way, putting a spotlight on some of these books, they're great books that wouldn't get a spotlight without this. So now, we also want to remember we audit the ways we suggest books. So we want to make sure that we are book talking books properly. Now, let me give you an example. When you book talk or write an annotation for a white, heteronormative, able-bodied person book, do you point any of that out? Do you say, hey, this book features white, heteronormative, able-bodied people? I know you don't, because I don't do that either. But when you book talk a title featuring a Hispanic character or a gay character, for example, why do people go out of their way to point that out? First of all, that's a huge problem because it assumes that the white heteronormative able-bodied people books are standard. So it's a microaggression, one that well-meaning people make all the time. I have done it myself. But it also helps no one because that's not the appeal of the book. The appeal has to do in the way in which the author tells the story. Again, it's our RA basics, right? Pace, storyline, language, tone, mood frame, etc. So sometimes the diversity is important, right? But it's not always. So here are a couple of books that I could book talk that don't mention the diversity at all. Now, I do want to say, you know, they hint at the diversity, but they don't necessarily make it part of the appeal. You don't be like, hey, you want to read a Native American book? Go read there, because there's urban Indians. Like, you know, again, if you would say Indian, I did that on purpose because it's microaggression doubly. You know, don't do that, right? So when you book talk, my favorite author to book talk is Colson Whitehead, because he writes about everything, right? So I love book talking Underground Railroad. It's the easiest book in the world to book talk, because all you have to say is, imagine that during the time of the, you know, slavery, that there's an Underground Railroad, or that the Underground Railroad is an actual road going underground, taking people to freedom. Go. Like, that tells you it's speculative, that tells you it's historically based, that tells you it has magic, it tells you where it takes place. Or one of my other favorite books is Pachinko by Min-Jin Lee. And Pachinko, I describe it as, my soundbite is, and these are all in the notes, by the way, on the live slides, the great American 20th century novel, except, do you like that big saga? Except it's not set in America. It's set in Korea it's set in Japan with Korean immigrants. And it tells the story of the 20th century from that lens. Go. Like, I love that book. You know, because it's like everything you think you know, but from a totally different perspective. And it does come over to America for parts of it. And A Silver Sparrow by Tayari Jones, which is a book, an older title. I love to book talk backlist titles, especially by popular authors. Silver Sparrow was one of my little old white ladies book club's favorite books years ago. But it's so easy to book talk without bringing up the diversity of the characters anyway, although people will know because they know about American Marriage and they know who Tayari Jones is. Tayari Jones. But here's how you book talk it, and it's great. It's super fun to book talk. Imagine it's the 1980s in Atlanta, and there are two sisters. They're half sisters, and they have the same father. One of them knows about the other's existence, and the other doesn't. And as they get older, their circles, which have been kept apart, their lives start to overlap. And what happens? Oh my gosh, it's such a great story. And it doesn't matter that, because the appeal isn't anything to do with the fact that they're Black teens in Atlanta. Okay, those are just some examples. And I have a few more titles listed there. Okay, now I want to talk about collecting diversely. And this is where I've had my additions with the American dirt controversy, which some of you may be aware of, that's happening right now. The obvious thing about collecting diversity is that we have to buy books by own voices, authors, right? But our obstacle is that publishing is too white. And this is an ongoing problem, and it's one that everybody keeps bringing up. And I'm really hoping that this controversy with the book American Dirt, if you don't know about it, I do not have a ton of time to go into it today. Oprah named it the book yesterday. I added this link from Slate because I went through all of the recaps. I've been waiting like to the last minute because I knew I was doing this talk, and they do a really good job talking about it. But basically, a white lady wrote what is being called trauma porn. But it's a book that's gotten a lot of push by the publisher. I was given copies at ALA in June in DC and told this was like the best book that was going to be coming out in 2020. I'll tell you, I didn't read it, but I was uncomfortable with it right away, seeing that it was about the Mexican refugee crisis at the border, and it was written by a white lady. So there are some issues here, and a lot of people have spoken out about it. Lauren Groff did a review of it in the New York Times a long time ago, before the controversy came out. They had, at her book launch back at like a few months ago, they had barbed wire vases, which is really uncomfortable and unsettling. I was not at that. But Lauren Groff talked about how the whole book kind of made her uncomfortable, but she couldn't look away. And she didn't even know, you know, any of the stuff we all know now. But this would not have happened if people would not have given her $1 million advance and promoted her, this is the book of the year, back, you know, 6 months before it was coming out, if they had anybody of color making decisions. Because as soon as I had Silvia Moreno Garcia, who's a very well-known Mexican-American author, Gods of Jade and Shadow was a library we picked last year. She came out right away when the book came out and she said, you had given this to a Mexican person to read at all, they would have noticed a whole bunch of things that were not only racist, but wrong. And she started listing like the names of the characters. No one would have called them Luca, it would have been Lucas. And she had all these other things she was talking about on Twitter that just wouldn't have, if they had had one Mexican pre-reader. And the fact that they didn't even think that was important is a huge issue. So I realize it's hard to collect diversity when the publishers are making it really hard. So the major publishers are worse. If we add books from a wider pool and we look at small presses, which as a rule tend to be more diverse because they can take more risks, because they're trying to find the undiscovered people. We also look at self-publishing. I mean, I didn't even put in any of the romance writers links on this because that's like a whole nother thing. I had those in there and I was going to do them, but I think it's better to talk more broadly. But self-publishing is a really good place to look too, because a lot of really good authors of color especially feel more comfortable doing it on their own and being in charge of their own message, as you can see from the American Dirt issue. And genre titles tend to be more diverse. And I have a link there that talks more about that. But how do we identify resources, especially if you're at a library where you have to have reviews in order to purchase something? I totally get this, right? So let's identify resources. One of my favorite things to do to try to find small press and self-published authors of color that are worth your time and non-binary and LGBTQ is to use the Amazon bestseller lists and backtrack. The very specific, uber specific backlists, right? This is something I talk to people all the time who need to buy urban fiction. It's something I've been telling people to do forever. Go to the urban fiction bestsellers, and that link goes to all the Amazon bestsellers, right? Find a title or a subject of interest, and then find an area of interest in a bestseller list, and then urban fiction, and then find the best 10 titles. Look at what the current 10 bestsellers are. Look into them, and then backtrack. Read reviews by the customers who have bought the book and read it, then go and do a Google search for reviews of those books. Maybe you'll find them from some blogs or some reputable websites. Go to Goodreads and look up more reviews. Backtrack to find reviews. And then once you identify a publisher you like, you can then start identifying more books by that publisher and add them. It takes longer, but it's a really good way to do it. You do have to also be able to order from more than just Ingram and Baker Taylor if you're going to do this. You need to be able to order paperbacks from Amazon. And it's worth giving a book a try. Now, another way to do it that's a little less risk, and this is happening more and more with all the problems with ebooks on Overdrive with especially Macmillan and others not giving their books access to libraries. Overdrive is working really hard to have more small presses, to have more self-publishing. They recently lowered the barrier for self-published authors to get in to their database. I've talked to a few very, very small presses, and it's so much easier now. Overdrive is trying to add more diverse voices. That is a great way to try out authors at your library and get around the whole there's no reviews. So my friend orders for Naperville Public Library. It's the third biggest city in Illinois. And she said that's something she does a lot with books of all small presses, and especially of diverse titles and own voices titles. She's adding them to Overdrive. She sees if they get popular, especially with genre readers in the genres. And if they do, then she's easily able to argue that she needs to add a print copy because the readership is so high on Overdrive. Again, we want to backtrack and find ways to get those books in. A lot of the writers' associations, maybe not RWA with romance writers, but a lot of the other ones, work really hard to try to help you identify less well-represented authors, underrepresented authors, marginalized authors. The Sears table is the Horror Writers Association's example. I am on the board of the Horror Writers Association, but Linda Addison, who I mentioned before, created the Sears table with the Diverse Works Inclusion Group of the Horror Writers. And every single month, they offer women and people of color and LGBTQ peoples for you to look at, for people in the horror community to be aware of, people that are worth your time to hear about and to read about, with a start with title. Not only is this a great resource for you to identify people in the horror genre that are really good in writing diverse works, but one of the reasons they started it was to make the awards less white. And we are seeing, we just had the preliminary ballot come out. And a few days ago, I wrote a long post about that on my blog. It is, we're seeing women and we're seeing people of color not only show up on the ballots, but win at a higher rate since the Sears table has started. And the final thing is that when we're trying to collect diversely, we need to find our patrons who read specific books, who like specific types of books, and any readers, like I said, going to Goodreads, and fans, especially when we're talking about genre. Let's find the fans and find out who they're reading and then try to add those books. I always was able to use patron recommendations as a reason to buy, or patron suggestion as a reason to buy a book. So if you're having trouble getting that diverse book in because there's no official review, and you know what? The administrative hurdles are there, but I loved usurping them. And by the way, I'm a trustee also, so I am all for breaking the rules if you can find a way to do it legally. So I used to have my patrons suggest books that I wasn't allowed to order, and then it was a patron suggestion, so I was allowed to order it. So you just tell your patrons you really like, hey, take a look at these books. Do they look interesting to you? Yes, great. Fill out this form, submit it online, and now I can order the book. There's nothing wrong with that. They don't even know about them. Again, discoverability is an issue, which we're going to deal with in a minute. The beginning of the discoverability issue is the read-alike problem. Before I go any further, I need to do this. And this GIF tells the entire story of what's happening. We are setting more fires as we're putting them out. This slide is full of links, okay? You need to spend time at, if no other slide, on this slide and read more about what I've written about these. But here's the basic problem. We tend to only suggest diverse authors for other diverse authors, okay? Or we think we are elevating own voices authors by giving them a quote-unquote white read-alike. I hate saying that. I always have trouble. White read-alike. Both of these are huge problems that cause a chain reaction that is hurting all of us who are arguing for EDI and RA service, because we're creating faulty read-alike lists that are, no matter how well-meaningly created, hindering us with their microaggression and privilege. And we're not going to move forward. If we have bad resources, we cannot move forward. We need to build read-alike lists that are based on appeal, not race or sexual orientation or whatever it is that isn't appeal. Okay, so let's talk about this a little bit. Just because Stephen King is a white male doesn't mean people who like Stephen King only want white male readers. I use Stephen King as an example, even though he kind of put his foot in his mouth a few days ago. I use him as an example because Stephen King is a great author that is a bestseller, right? And bestsellers is a genre. People say they don't read horror, they don't read fantasy, they don't read science fiction, but they read Stephen King, because everyone reads Stephen King. I've really rarely met a person who's never read Stephen King in their life. And the fact of the matter is, the way he tells the story has nothing to do with the fact that he's a white male. So I have a much more inclusive read-alike list for Stephen King that actually is inclusive both in the color of the skin, the sexual sex, the sexual orientation of the people, but also the genre, because he writes across genre and people like his books and they like the way he tells the story. So that's one issue, right? I also talk about Luis Alberto Urrea, who Enrita likes for him. So this is a standard literary fiction author that is up for awards all the time. One of his books is the one of the official NEA big reads. This is an author that makes all the best lists when he has a new book. His last book was like a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize. He's won the Pulitzer Prize for his reporting. A Mexican-American author, lives here in Illinois. Actually, he also lives in Naperville. I made a mini rant about how I'm so sick of seeing people either make other white Pulitzer Prize winning authors as Rita likes for him, or only Mexican authors for him. And you know what really makes me upset? If you actually think about the appeal of Luis Alberto Urrea, and I've had no one disagree with me on this yet, but we really sit down and think about the appeal, the author he is most like is Luis Erdrich, who is a Native American. And writes about High Plains Native Americans. Some of it is their Midwest sensibility, yes, but they both write in a way that puts the characters at the forefront and have sort of an underlying, it's not really magical realism because there's not magic, but it has this feeling that is sort of fairy tale while still being realistic. And they write in this way that just draws you into the place and the people, so character centered, and tells the story in a way that just draws you in and has you participate. That is not to say that other Mexican American authors don't write like Luis Alberto Urrea, but if we only are giving the Rita likes for him that are elevating him, quote unquote, by giving him other white prize winning authors or only Mexican authors and not considering the appeal, it's a problem. Here's an even bigger problem that happened because of one of these talks. Someone said to me, Becky, I love what you're doing. I'm trying to find, and I didn't have this slide in there at the time. I'm trying to find non-white male Rita likes for David Baldacci. I'm trying to update my David Baldacci Rita likes. And I actually, this is when I identified the inherent racism and sexism in our resources. And I talk about it at length. But basically, it's even worse, this problem, the Luis Alberto Urrea problem, when we talk about a genre that is less, quote unquote, elevated than literary fiction, which Urrea writes. We talk about thrillers, right? Because then what happens is people start tagging the Rita likes for people of color and non-binary and LGBTQ. They'll call them literary thrillers, even though they're just thrillers. So when we're doing a research for Rita likes for David Baldacci, we're only getting other thrillers that are by like white men, because if it's by a person of color, it's already got the literary merit. You're not helping by putting the word literary. In fact, my friend from Naperville I mentioned before said that that was why she loves thrillers, but she always dismissed books that said they were literary thrillers, and she just wouldn't read them because she doesn't want literary thrillers. She wants straight thrillers. So again, look for more. But also, like I said, commit to never having only straight white male authors as your read-alike options. And make sure you think about the appeal. Here's an example now, because all my another example of a book by a white woman, The Seven or Eight Deaths of Stella Fortuna. Juliet Graham is her name. And so this was a great women-centered immigrant story that came out last May. It got lots of great critical acclaim, was on a lot of best debuts of the year list. And go look at my read-alikes, because what my read-alikes are other immigrant experiences. And it can be from any culture. The people in this book, the woman in this book, Stella, is from Italy. But it can be any immigrant story. So let's consider that. Okay. Now, another way we can put EDI values at the forefront and get more organic diversity at our library is by including more staff. We should not only include our professional, quote unquote, staff in our work for readers advisory. I talk about this at length when I give presentations. Our support staff as a whole is more diverse than the 88% white ladies that we are. So when we work together as a staff, we're hitting not only more diverse voices, but the readership, not everyone's reading the same things. And so in general, we want to make sure we're pulling information from all of our staff. So I talk about everyone on staff can somehow more easily participate in Reader's Advisory. And I have a step-by-step guide to how you can get everybody book talking better and including everyone in book talks, how the library talks about books. But the easiest way to do it is to make it easier for staff to participate in your staff recommendation shelves. Every single member of your staff, whether they're the janitor or the director, should be able to have a book on the staff recommendation shelf, as long as they like to read. Or it doesn't even have to be books, it can be anything you check out. But the fact of the matter is, we make it too hard. We say they have to write an annotation, no. Tell everybody to get a Goodreads shelf, And actually get your, I tell people who already have a personal Goodreads shelf is to create another one for their library. Then the library can gather those all together into a one library shelf. But somebody on staff can be in charge of checking. So basically, if you read a book, you give it 5 stars, you're giving the library permission to put it on the shelf. Make it easier. Don't put up so many barriers. The more voices we have participating, the more inclusive and diverse in every sense of the word our staff recommendation shelves will be. You will find out that there are people that read in these super micro genres that are really popular, but you didn't know because they don't work in that department. So like my children's librarian staff at my library, when I worked at the library, our best erotic romance reader worked in children's. But we didn't know that till we asked because, well, she can't talk about erotic romance at the desk. Gotta ask. Make it easier to participate. So make it clear, if you have some questions, you should start typing them in. I'm going to finish within 10 minutes so we can do questions. So I just want to do some quick reminders before we go on to the very end. I want to remind you that you need to incorporate own voices titles into part of everything you do. So you want to make sure you're book talking. You want to make sure you're suggesting them. You want to make sure they're on your lists. But even more important, we have to think about discovery, right? So I have a much longer piece about how to include terms that will make the books more discoverable by the patrons who aren't actively seeking your help or while they're searching. And the great thing is that when we have the online public access catalogs, that we can add anything we want. But by the way, I talk about it in that post, but like, you know, subject headings are fairly racist, and this is a known thing. And I have examples, but they're not very good at staying up to date. So you can add your own keyword terms in every OPAC available these days. There's no rules that says you can't. It's much better than creating shelves. And I talk about the difference between why it's bad to segregate books by people of color into their own shelves and why the argument that, well, then people can find them doesn't work. Again, microaggression. You're saying everything else is a standard and these are special and need their own place. You're not helping them. You're helping by putting the books together. Again, read about it, but discovery is one of those steps that we are not. It's an action that we need to take. It might seem passive because we're not, it's not us actively pushing the books, but it is just as important. It's an action we can take behind the scenes to make sure that these books get noticed and found. And we need to lead by example. You guys are going to be the change bringers and you've got to just do it. Sometimes I feel like I only talk about books that are own voices titles, and I'm okay with that because somebody's got to do it. And I know that the books by white people are going to get talked about. When you see microaggressions happening, you need to politely mention them and call people out, like I mentioned at the beginning. Please don't let them keep going. If somebody is really spending a lot of time talking about the race of a main character, be like, is that really what the book's about? You know, let's talk about how we can improve. And just inspire by your leadership. Don't be a jerk like, I know this and you don't, because you're going to make an example too. And we're going to talk about that. Here's an example of examples of mistakes I've made, because we have to keep listening. I know I said act, and be a leader, but you're still a white lady, probably 88% of you. You need to just be quiet and make room for the marginalized voices. Let them tell their story. Let them speak. I'm going to skip to the bottom. Your white fragility is something that exacerbates the problem. April Hathcock, who I mentioned at the beginning, had a piece just a couple days ago, just yesterday, I think, or today, about how it hurts her to go to all these diversity trainings, to be one of the only black faces in these trainings, and to watch the people's anguish with, oh, I have to confront my white fragility, when she's just lived with it her whole life, the fact that she's been marginalized. Listen. Stop being like, oh, look how much I'm doing. Just quietly lead by example. Put it at the forefront. Make sure you're thinking about EDI and you're auditing and you're thinking about it. But also listen. I have a much longer post there too. Again, in to save time, I'm not going to tell you the whole story. But the short version is it's about a trans author I met who's also a librarian, and how listening to her opened me up to a whole new understanding of the trans community and their stories and how she's worked to educate me. And it has a review of one of her books too. So I think you should take a look at that. But I've learned so much from her just by listening. And I talk about it and how actually Victor Laval, an African-American horror author, was the one that reminded me to listen to her. So you can read that when you have a chance, but just remember to listen. And also admit when you misstep. Don't just correct the microaggressions of others, admit it. So I mentioned that multicultural word before. That's the word I used to use. It's the word a lot of us used to use. I invited Sonali Dev, an Indian American romance author to speak at ILA. And we were talking, she also lives in Naperville. I did not do this on purpose. I invited her and she got up there and she said, one time I was reading a review of my book in the New York Times or somewhere, like in a romance roundup. She's like, and they said that it was a multicultural romance. And she's like, I stopped reading. And I said, did they read my book? Because it's only Indian people. There's nothing multi about the culture. And again, it's a term that we had, that white people had used, trying to be well-meaning, saying it's not about white people. But by calling it multicultural when it only dealt with one culture, that's a microaggression, right? It's saying there's a standard that's white and everything else is multicultural. At my library, with the help of our LGBT community, we years ago put alternative lifestyle stickers on the LGBTQ books. And that's really awful too. It does the same thing, right? There's a standard and there's an alternative. It was well-meaning. We had a large lesbian population. They helped us pick the sticker. Still, you can admit it's a mistake and fix it. Again, I mentioned this briefly, but not interfiling POC and LGBTQ authors is a microaggression. If you've done it, don't worry about it. Just fix it. Read that post from the slide before about making them discoverable in the OPAC. And I talk about how you can make them discoverable and how you can help your readers find them if they want to create like a mini African-American author section. They can do it online for themselves. And again, there's the article about how white, you don't let your white fragility get in the way. Again, we're listening and learning and we're not going to react or feel attacked. Move on. Admit your mistakes and move on. And I want to remind everyone as we finish up here, I know I've talked about a lot of things. It really is a marathon. It is not a sprint. I'm sorry, and it's a lot of work, and we have to keep doing it. But, you know, worry about yourself first. That's where we're all starting today, right? Set the example. And remember that your work and your collections need to represent the world at large, not just the people in your community. If you happen to live in a town that isn't that diverse, that doesn't mean you only get to collect white books, because the world is not just white. I want to spend a little bit of time, and you can go to the longer post about this, and read you something I've written previously, because I think it's really important. Whiteness as Collection was a piece that came out by a woman named Sophia Luang, who's a academic librarian and scholar. It came out last year, and I linked to the piece in the piece you have there where that link is. And it really got me upset. She was talking about academic libraries, and she was being attacked for saying that, you know, our collections in academic libraries are too white and we have to fix this. And people were telling her, what do you want us to do, burn all the books in it? And I really thought about it. And so I had some things to say about it. And I realized that I want to talk about public libraries, because our collections at every library are way out of proportion. The amount of materials written by and from the white male perspective greatly outnumber everything else. We should be striving to bring our collections into proportion with the racial and gender mix of our country and of our world. Our collections should represent us as a people, and as we shift and change, so too should our collections. And I did not write this down, but collections are not static, right? Why are people upset with the completely rational and well-founded argument that she made that I just paraphrased? I know it's because white people feel threatened by the fact that POC are actively speaking up about injustice that they have known and fought for their entire lives, but often without bringing it up to the wider public discourse, because they knew what was gonna happen. They were gonna get shot down, right? An injustice that white people haven't even noticed, because we have just made everything white as the standard and never considered how that affects those of us who don't fit our standard. Now, I want all of you to do something for me right now. Imagine that you, as a white person, because again, let's face it, most of you are, have only ever been in a library where the vast majority of scholarship and leisure reading was built on a non-white perspective. That is the issue every person who is not white, heteronormative, or able-bodied deals with every single time they are in one of our libraries or use them for research. You would hate it, you would feel unwelcome, and you would feel like the world was against you just by walking in. It's a much deeper issue than anyone who lives within their white world can imagine, even if you're trying to imagine it. Our entire amassed and cataloged knowledge as humanity is built off of one single viewpoint. And instead of trying to recalibrate it, we're getting upset and attacking the messenger. And what I want to tell you is, as a profession, we need to act. You should be angry that this imbalance has persisted for so long. You should use your energy to work to make our collections better. Start with yourself, because while you may be located in one place, your patrons are citizens of this country and of our world, and they need to see its wonderful breadth reflected in our collections. Everyone needs to read books by and about everyone. We need to start recalibrating our collections, stop being mad at the people who are calling attention to the problem, and start being part of the solution. And by coming to this, you are trying to be part of the solution, but coming to this talk today is not enough. Some people like to give up because they're like, the problem's too big, I can't deal with it, or I have too much pushback at work. And you also can't think your work is done because you came here. You must keep working and know that it's not easy. And keep thinking about that. Think about what it would be like if you were on the other side. And when you are questioned, react appropriately. This is something that came up. Someone asked me once at one of these talks in Wisconsin, in a room full of all white people and two people of color, I was starting to talk about own voices at some point, and someone raised their hand, a really well-meaning white man, and God bless him for doing it, and I'm so proud of him for speaking up. He's like, what does own voices mean? And I literally saw the one of the two people of color put their head in their hand and shake their head. I feel bad, but at least he asked, right? So I explained to him that own voices means the author is speaking from their experience and it's a not white perspective. And he was like, oh, okay, thank you. We need to react appropriately. Don't just bite the head off of people who are trying to learn, and be understanding. I mean, obviously some people are just outright racist, and that's harder to combat, and that's a whole other issue. But most people are just trying, and they just don't understand the issue and how complex it is. So I'm gonna finish up here by telling you that you need to just keep going, read and suggest and promote and collect, just keep doing it, but all with that EDI mission, that lens in front of you, and just do it over and over and over again. So the slides are on RA for All. You just go there, it's under today's date, and you can always email me comments after and interact with me on Twitter, and I am good for questions.
All right, excellent. We have a few. One is, and I'm gonna ask this one first just in case you don't know. Okay.
I don't care, it's fine.
Yes, the first one is, what are your thoughts on paper RA interviews or Reader's Advisor interviews?
Oh, so you mean like a form-based Reader's Advisory, right? So that's a great form of passive Reader's Advisory. And in it, so when I do those are actually the best place to put EDI in there. And Skokie was one of the libraries that did this first. They audited their book match program that's based on those and realized how white those suggestions they were giving were. So we're asking people in those paper Reader's Advisory issues for the very general appeal factors, right? We're asking them for the kind of pacing they want. We're asking them for the type of characterization, the genres they prefer, the formats they prefer. When you give back recommendations, I normally see that people for paper forms do 3 to 5 recommendations. That tends to be the standard. I would tell you to, again, audit what you're giving. Unless they outright say they want books by people from different perspectives of their own. Because I always, by the way, that's a good point too, in those paper forms, always include a section on tell me something else that isn't asked on this form that you really care about, and give them like text to do that. So what I do is I say audit your suggestions, right? So we go back to the idea that 30% of your suggestions need to be own voices or diverse offerings. So if you're giving, 3 books, one has to be. You cannot have only 3 white books, especially 3 white male books. So you don't have to have all 3 be that if the person, you don't know if that's gonna work, but always 30%. At the minimum. I'm making a standard. I'm trying to do even more, especially if it fits with what's going on. I do that. So that's how you audit yourself.
Excellent.
But I should say, I don't outright ask, like, do you want books by Black people? Or do you want, like, don't do that. But again, just like I said, you don't want to book talk the person's identity. You want to book talk the appeal. All right. Sorry.
Okay. Next. That's great. Okay. And this, you did cover quite a bit about this, but if you have any other tips about this, this is from someone who says, what do you say to patrons or boards who argue that the collection development principle of reflecting your community means you shouldn't spend too much of your limited budget on books reflecting lots of cultures that aren't present in this?
And I can speak both as someone who was a collection development librarian and as a trustee. I think that, first of all, if that's explicitly what your collection development policy says, and I've worked on many collection development policies, that's a problem. Because your patrons are citizens of the world. And one of the things the library does is open the world to people, no matter where they live. And I know for a fact that all those libraries that say that collect travel books from all over the world. And so if you're collecting travel books, then that is a reason why you should be collecting books by people with perspectives from all over the world. We're trying to help people have access to the world through the public library. That's always something we've tried to do. And so we need to make sure that we are giving people enough perspectives that allow them to become citizens of the world. And again, it's why in my EDI statement, I'm gonna give everybody some nausea and go back maybe. Maybe I can go, oops, that didn't work. Okay, now you're on Twitter, so that's not cool. let me pull up my, that was my Twitter because I clicked on it. Let me pull up. Well, that might not work. Okay, my EDI statement. Let's go back. Okay, here, I got it. Sorry. My mission statement. Let me present that. So I even say libraries that hire AirFOL must be interested in allowing all staff to participate in serving all populations, not just the ones most represented by staff or as identified in a local census. So I do address that in my EDI mission statement because I think it's so important. Again, that's your argument. And so what you do need to do then is, if that's in your collection development policy, you need to update that because that's just not what libraries have done. I remember learning about that in library school, right? The People's University, the history of the public library, giving people a window to the world. Like, that's been in what we do forever. So yeah, that's the end of that.
Excellent. And that took us exactly to 2 o'clock. So thank you so much, Becky, for this webinar. It was great. As mentioned, this session recording and slides will be posted on the conference website by January 24th, and Becky already gave you access to the slides anyway. Our next session in this track is with Adriana McClear, and that begins at 2:30, and we hope to see you there, but if not, hope you have a great rest of your day. And I'm going to stop recording.